1, 2, 3.
Hello and welcome to the Bottlecap Entertainment Podcast, Uncapped. I am CEO Timothy Lockwood, and today I have with me Mr. Craig Topping.
Good evening.
Who is our creative director here at Bottlecap Entertainment. We're trying a podcast. We're going to sort of sit here, talk about new movies, our thoughts, some other stuff as well. We've got a fair bit of good stuff today, so we're going to start with that. So, what have you got to talk about? What have you brought today?
I think one of the main things that I kind of wanted to talk about mainly because I don't know if I feel like I want to rant about it or laugh about it, is Tom Cruise returned to Top Gun 2. That's one of the main things at the moment.
I mean, I think you can't do Top Gun without Tom Cruise.
True, but why can't you not just leave it?
Well, I mean, we did, with a confession to make, we did do a trial run podcast before this, just to kind of see what was going on, and It went well, so we decided that that's why we're going to do this. Mm. And we did actually bring this up last time. Didn't we say that there was... they're changing what Top Gun is or something, isn't it? And it's all about drone...
Yeah, something about that. I'm pretty sure when we said about it, Tom Cruise wasn't confirmed to be in the sequel. So I think that was what we were mainly talking about. He's only just confirmed
He's
it.
Only... Yeah. But I think it kind of cements my theory of that... It's going to be that we know it's about drone warfare.
Yeah.
And so I've got this probable feeling that because drones, you don't need Top Gun anymore. So it's going to be one of those things of like, no, drones, real pilots can outperform drones. So that's what it's going to be.
Yeah, it's all unmanned warfare, which again, still not too sure.
I think it could be interesting because they did, there's a film starring, I think it's Helen Mirren. Mm. Yeah, it's called Eye in the Sky. Have you ever heard of that?
I have not, no.
It's one of those real-time movies. So the 2 hours that the movie is actually two hours within the universe of the movie. And it's all about a drone strike, drone operation. But it all takes place in the command center.
Oh, right.
I haven't seen it. So if anybody has seen it, feel free to comment. Tell me that it's either amazing or awful or somewhere in between. But
if it's Helen Mirren, let's be honest, it's going to be good.
Yeah, it should be pretty good.
We'd hope so anyway. What else was there released? You got Predator. There's more trailers of Predator.
Okay, I actually had heard nothing about Predator.
You have no idea about Predator?
I have no idea about Predator. God, that's awful.
See, the only thing is I've seen, it seems a lot more action-y that I'm not too happy about. I'm not too happy about it looking quite action-y.
But it's Predator.
Yeah, but if you think Predator about is Arnie's, like, Arnie's version, it was like, oh, he's in the trees, we're going to die.
He's in the trees, so therefore we spray 4,000 rounds into the trees.
Yeah, exactly. It's a fear tactic, rather than, oh crap, there's a thing right there, we get stabbed.
Yeah, something like that. But I mean, I liked the original Predator, but I haven't seen Predator in God knows how long. I really should rewatch Predator.
I think the last Predator thing I ever saw was Alien vs. Predator Requiem, which was good.
Yeah,
that was
it was passable. That's generous.
Yeah,
isn't
that's really generous.
They say they both take a drink.
Yeah.
no, I mean I think it's not like it's not going to make any money.
Yeah, but and that's the problem.
Filmmaking is a business. You must make money. Although, tell that to Skyscraper. But
Hotel Transylvania. Yeah,
we'll get onto that. Yeah. But I don't know. Filmmaking seems to have become at the minute a lot of remakes and superhero franchises. I'm going to sound like such a annoying person when I say this.
You almost said it.
Yeah, I almost said it. Almost went. We've promised ourselves no swearing throughout this production, but
I said no such thing.
Yeah. Mentally, we both made a mental connection, regardless of whether he acknowledges it or not. It's like if you want to do anything individual, it doesn't.
You can't anymore.
The most individual thing that I can think of in most recent years that I was like, whoa, I haven't seen anything like this that's this good is John Wick. Like I Like, yeah. From a filmmaking standpoint, with
that
the,
was yeah.
It's
between
gorgeous.
That and Get Out. Because I might just be a sucker for Get Out because I've always liked the stylistic approach. I've liked the social look at everything. I like that idea, but I don't know. It might just be me.
I know. I liked Get Out. I didn't think there was anything wrong with it. It was just it felt that the marketing team did a very good job. I'm gonna say that. That's all I'm gonna say on terms of Get Out. But I mean, I still think that John Wick is one of the best movies in.
Without a doubt,
just because of the way that it's an action film that doesn't rely on shaky cam, which love. It's everything is so choreographed and fits perfectly together, and it's like, I mean, with a pencil. It's especially in the second one. It's
with a pencil.
It's such a fluid film that there's only it's such a simplistic idea as well. Mm. Major Hitman retires. Someone kills his dog, goes on killing spree. It's like when you boil
it's
it down
Sunday
to
Sunday evening.
That's all the film is. Mm. But it just
it hits
so
a note that
good.
Not many other
so
films
good.
Do.
And see that we do have down on the list is Taron Egerton in the new Robin Hood film.
Yes,
I read an article where they are trying to replicate the John Wick style, but bows and arrows and stuff.
Dog hitting the microphone.
we do have a third member with us today who is the dog.
He's not very good at English.
Yeah,
so.
No, he doesn't. He's not fluent yet. He's got woof down, which is quite good, I think.
Yeah, all right. See, the only thing with Robin Hood, though, have you seen the CW show Arrow?
I've seen bits of it because
I'm quite a big superhero fan anyway, and when I first watched Arrow, as soon as I saw the trailer, instantly just brought memories back.
When you saw the trailer for Robin Hood.
Yeah, not when I saw Arrow, it brought Arrow memories back. No, when I saw Robin Hood, it just... I don't know if it was the stylistic approach where the camera was done. I don't know if it was just the action style of it. Yeah. It just seemed very arrowy.
It seemed very arrowy. That's all. Mm. I mean, that is good. I think it's definitely interesting. And it's something that I will go and see. Definitely. Yeah. It's because it's Robin Hood. I like Robin Hood.
I think you mean it's Taron Egerton. Let's be honest, you have a crush on him.
Well,
who doesn't?
I mean, the man is gorgeous. I think, but no, I think there are now. There is always one film every 5 to 10 years that comes in and completely changes it.
Yeah.
And I think in terms of action movies, that's definitely been John Wick.
And
the other thing that completely the trailer for a new film also that's coming out that I just screams that John Wick had a good idea there. I am going to talk about Hotel Artemis.
Yep.
Which looks like a great film. I really want to see it. It's going to be interesting when it comes out. But again, it's like, oh, you saw John Wick and you like the idea of the Continental.
The only thing about that for me, is the antagonist, Jeff Goldblum. He looks exactly the same in every other film nowadays. Like back when Independence Day, the original one came out. But he's always been the same. He will find a way.
But Jeff Goldblum is Jeff Goldblum. He's brilliant. Like, have you seen?
Is he though?
But have you?
I'm sorry. I'm probably in the minority here. But is he?
He's a very good actor.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Because
otherwise he wouldn't be working. There you go.
But he plays the same character. I mean, a lot of actors do this. A lot of actors do this. But he plays the exact same character.
Well, I don't necessarily think sometimes that's up to him because that's in some ways the casting directors. We saw you in this. True. We liked what you did. Can you do it again with different lines in this movie?
Yeah, that's true. Actually,
you can't. I don't think of course, you can blame the actors in some way for not bringing something completely fresh.
Yeah.
But still, if you're going to get cast in a certain type of movie,
you're going to have to deliver what they want.
Yeah,
that's true.
Yeah, I think actors don't have as much creative freedom as people think they do. No. You hear about things with like people like in Apocalypse Now where Marlon Brando didn't learn his lines at the end and did like 4 hours of improvised stuff and then ended up going to Francis Ford Coppola, that's it, I can't do anymore, and then they just had to cut it in. Do you know it took them 2 years to edit that movie?
Seriously?
It took them 2 years to edit Apocalypse Now because they shot 240 hours worth of footage on that movie, and the film reel was one and a half million feet. 1.5 million feet of celluloid film.
Yeah, I'm good. That's what I leave.
They had four editors on that movie, but it's
four for a million.
I mean, yeah, it's like
might take a little bit longer.
Probably around that. I mean,
but that release date must have got pushed back more than. Well,
it was supposed to premiere at Cannes, and then and then it didn't, and then they premiered it the next year, and it won the Palme d'Or. I can never pronounce that properly.
The what, sorry?
The big prize. The big one. Gold medal. Well done. You've done very well. You have the best movie at Cannes.
Right, okay.
Apocalypse Now won that. Because who doesn't love the smell of napalm in the morning? Craig is raising his hand.
I forgot there's no cameras.
Yeah. That's another thing that we should address. I mean, we probably sound like... No, we can't really say we sound like the voices of God. We sound like the voices of two dimwits trying to talk about movies.
Voices of God.
But what we, by the time you're actually hearing this, it will be edited and it will look lovely. Thanks to Craig, who will have done some gorgeously brilliant editing. So we're still working out the kinks of this kind of stuff, but it's definitely.
I apologise if it looks absolutely terrible.
It won't. I mean, Craig.
No, it won't.
Craig has done our. If you hopefully by now, if you haven't, we're going to do a little plug here.
Please watch it.
The blooper reel for Crossed Wires that we did, which Craig also was the cinematographer on. Craig edited the blooper reel, and which, if you ask me, and I think most of the other people that have seen it, is bloody hilarious. especially with the editing and the sections with the Joker and Mr. Grey is just really. It's stellar editing, my friend.
I have to admit, some of that is a lot. Well, I say some of that. All of it is quite fun to edit. Whenever I get stuff like that, it's quite fun to edit.
You've got to enjoy editing.
Yeah, exactly.
And this is the other thing that we're kind of talking about as well. Not so much just actual movies that are coming out, but the process of filmmaking. Because of course, we've made two films and a blooper reel at this point. But we are
working on the third.
We are working on a third movie. We've all been very, very decently busy over recent times, so we haven't had as much of a chance to come together. We try and do this as much as we possibly can, so there will be some times when it's like, yeah, we've got a whole month through, we're free, we can all meet together and we can all do some amazing thing that's going to be really cool. But
does that ever fall into plan? I don't think so.
I mean, there's filmmaking, you always have.
Yeah, exactly.
If you make three different movies. I think we spoke about this once. I can't remember who told me. I probably watched it on like a YouTube video or something, or an interview with someone, or probably Spielberg or something ridiculous like that. You make three different movies. So the first movie you make is when you write the script.
Yeah.
So that's all.
And then the second
then you make a second version of that movie.
Yep.
Which is when you actually go into production.
Yep.
And then you make a third movie when you edit it all together. But I mean, I think in terms of three different movies can be true, but then you have people who are, I'm sticking to this, and it's,
I don't think that's a good idea to go down that route though.
Yeah, if you're not rolling with the punches, you better have a seriously good reason for why you're doing something.
I don't know. I feel like if you're that one person that goes, right, I've got an idea, I'm sticking to it, I'm not changing anything about it. Even if you go down to the point where you do storyboards.
Yeah.
It keeps doing that. If you stick to that, I feel like you're in for a bad time.
Yeah.
After a while.
You've got to be flexible with your vision. It's great to have like what you want in the final product. Yeah. But most of the times I've found when I've been writing something and I've kind of... When we've made it, like our first short, Last Past the Post. When I wrote that, I had an idea for it and what I wanted it to look like.
Yes.
God, we did have some struggles when we were shooting that. We had to.
I wanted to shoot myself, didn't I?
Oh yeah, it was quite a struggle. We had Mr. Trey Pardy, who is our chief business officer, who unfortunately couldn't be here today, but hopefully he will be in the next podcast.
Hopefully.
With any luck. He will be. He will be. He's great. We really appreciate having Trey, and it's. But yeah, he was also a He was the first AC on that, first assistant camera on that, which basically involved him using a torch on his phone, uplighting our actors for us. So there you go, you got little on-set secrets that we can spill in this time as well.
You're welcome, everybody, because you all wanted to know.
Yeah, there's
bits that you need to know.
We're open to talking about.
Oh yeah.
Anything and everything in entertainment.
Yeah, exactly.
It's all good fun. Although I don't think either of us really listen to kind of top 40s music, so music probably isn't our strongest point to talk about. But we will have somebody definitely at some point who can
come and talk to us about
slap us
into shape.
Because I like electro funk, you like
rock.
Yeah, rock.
Boring.
Rock. Yeah,
rock.
Just generic rock.
Yeah.
I mean, I'll listen to anything pretty.
I think the only thing I steer clear from properly, I mean, there's been a few songs that I sort of come back to every now and then is rap. I'm not a fan.
I think there are some rap songs. Like, do you know Rapper's Delight by the Sugar Hill Gang?
Nope.
I said it hip.
Oh, the hippie.
Hip, hop, and you don't stop the rock until the bang, bang, boogie, sit up, jump,
yes,
the boogie,
to
the rhythm of the boogie to beat. Yeah, that's like, and I'm pretty sure someone will definitely correct me, but that's old school rap.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so that's, I like that, but some of the, like, Gucci Gang, I would rather, like,
Gucci Gang.
I'd rather take my eyeballs out with an ice cream scoop, to be honest, than listen to that.
That won't help. Yeah. Ears, you've got to go for. Ears.
Well, I mean, I haven't seen the video, but I probably still want to.
Don't.
Okay.
There's a CG tiger that I wish was real.
CG tiger.
Yeah. That.
Is it a good CG tiger?
It gave me a couple of double takes.
Because when CGI is done well, you can never notice it.
Yeah.
Like. I think the best example of that, and there's a couple of other movies as well that do this, but Planet of the Apes.
Yes,
he's like, and I've seen bits of. I haven't seen the whole of, but I've seen bits of War of the Planet of the Apes.
I've only seen Rise of. I haven't really seen the other two yet.
The CGI is just amazing.
I don't understand how they get it. Like, I don't know how. I can't imagine how.
So
many
people
have
the best,
to be on
the
that.
Best CGI is when it makes you truly believe that there is no CGI.
Yeah.
I mean, Life of Pi did it very well as well. I think.
I still haven't seen that film.
Life of Pi's great.
Still haven't seen.
I've seen
film.
It. I've seen it a couple of times. In fact, there are some really cool bits because they shoot it like it's shot like Letterboxd, classic cinema style. But there's a bit where it's not quite a storm, but there's a really big section of waves and loads of fish jump out the water, and a couple of the fish actually jump over the black letterbox.
Oh right.
And they come over the side of the straight out.
Oh right, yeah.
So it's a really interesting way of doing it.
Because isn't, not spoiling the ending, but isn't it, they sort of give you your own take. It's like, oh, you can either believe this or believe this, isn't it?
Yeah,
they show two different endings.
Yeah,
in a
but
sense.
there's a section where because he ends up, I'm sure everyone's seen it because that movie's what, 4 or 5 years old now?
2013, I think. So about 5 years.
Yeah, about 5 years old. So if you haven't seen it, hurry up.
That's an order.
Yeah. Because at the very end, he's kind of washed up on a beach, and it's led to believe that it's a lucid.
Spoiler alert.
Spoiler alert. He's washed up on a beach. You're led to believe that it's all been a hallucination, but he looks across, and he sees the tiger that he's been stranded on the boat with walk into the forest. But nobody else reacts to it, because they're all looking at him. So you don't know, you can either believe that it was real or he was actually hallucinating because the tiger isn't.
Oh, right.
To be honest with you, the tiger's probably a metaphor for like, believe what you want to believe. Something like that.
You can't handle the truth.
Oh my God. Brilliant film.
Yes.
Brilliant, 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 brilliant film. Who's it written by?
I cannot remember for the
life
of me.
Aaron Sorkin wrote that. Wrote The Social Network.
Oh right!
Yes.
Oh,
yeah.
Right.
Oh.
Right. Yes.
He's written so much.
Yes.
He does. If anybody's interested in learning writing and screenplay,
yes.
He does a masterclass online. I think it's 100 hours plus.
Talking,
and then there is a section where he has an actual masterclass for people who've written stuff, and he helps them improve their script. But it's seriously worth watching, especially if you like the ping pong dialogue of Aaron Sorkin that he's really known for.
So not like my dialogue. Okay, got it.
Yeah, no, no. I have a real thing for ping pong dialogue with lots of the stuff I write. It's always somebody going, what? What? I don't understand. What don't you understand? And just short, snappy, fast lines. I know that your average screenplay, in a screenplay, one page is 1 minute on average. So most of the time, a screenplay is 90 pages long. Aaron Sorkin normally hits around 170. Because there's so much dialogue in his films. So much. But still manages to... The Social Network is 2 hours plus, isn't it? But it's still 170 pages and it's just...
That's still a lot of dialogue.
Jesus. Because he started... he didn't want to be a screenwriter at the beginning. This is turning into an Aaron Sorkin
biopic. Yeah, hi.
But yeah, I know he studied musical theatre to start off with.
That's why you're so in love with him.
Yeah, I did. I did.
Yeah,
I studied musical theatre for a little while. So, but I like film. I prefer film overall. Although my dream is to direct a movie musical.
What, like La La Land?
No,
I knew that'd get your reaction.
Better than La La Land. Not that La La Land's a bad film. It's just not.
I guess I could hear the pitchforks coming out.
It's not a great movie. It's good. It's good. As he knows what's coming. It's good, but it's not quite Carling.
I can hear the pitchforks from everyone who loves musicals.
No, I think. But and same with I thought Beauty and the Beast, the live action one, was good. It was good. It could have been better.
I didn't see the point of it. Just
money.
Leave it.
Money. We've spoken about this. Money.
It's just, my head goes, if it gets you money, great. I understand that the film business is all about money.
It's got to have an artistic merit to it as well.
My head, especially after I'm going to come out with this right here. I had a crush on Belle when I was younger.
Who?
As in, yeah.
Oh, the animated version.
The animated version, not Emma Watson.
You sure you want to put that on the internet?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I've always seen that as the perfect childhood film. I haven't, but... It's always been that sort of film to shut up. Oh, I can see this
please,
backfiring.
Yeah, this is going to backfire massively.
I'll have directors and crap like that just look at me like, hey, Craig, so we saw a podcast from you the other day. Oh, yeah, what did you say? You said you fancied an animated girl.
Well, I think lots of, if there's anyone around, do you know what, we're not going to get into this.
Yeah, no, just...
We're not going to get into this. We're not going to get into this.
Right, carrying on with what we have planned rather than just...
I'm quite liking this off-script banter, to be honest. It feels more natural.
Yeah,
I said that in such a... yes, banter.
Yes, I love this off-script banter. The banter. Oh, yes. Oh, yes, Timothy.
Oh, okay, yeah. There's a follow-up to Get Out.
Yeah. We were talking about this just before we started podcasting, didn't we? We were saying how probably not going to be a sequel, but it's going to be
take place in the same universe. I wouldn't be surprised if they did... a lot of
brainwave. He's had a brainwave.
What if they're trying to run with Black Mirror?
No,
but in feature film format, so they make one every year, and then somehow they will all not every year, but every now and then, and then they all interlink with one another.
That'd be dangerous, though. I mean, with Black Mirror, I think
but you can still do it. It's like anthology, isn't?
Yeah, true.
It's not trademarked by Black Mirror.
No,
the format works because the program Black Mirror is so popular.
Only problem is now, and again, this is going off script or not off script, but
we don't have a script.
Yeah,
we've
exactly.
got notes. We're allowed.
Yeah, we're allowed. As in, like with Black Mirror, I think one of the things that surprised people that everyone loved about it when it first came out, and now it's sort of changed, is the fact that there was no connection. I mean, you could tell it was in the same shared universe because you had little Easter eggs from previous episodes and stuff like that. You could tell it's in the same shared universe, but there was no definitive connection
there
between
wasn't
each
anything
characters.
That was definitive link, yeah.
Whereas I think is it season 4 that's recently
season
come out?
Season 4 I've only is got up to
because
they're shooting three. They're shooting season 5 at the minute.
I've only got up to season 3, so I haven't watched it yet.
I've seen the first two episodes of season 4. In fact, one of them, which is Archangel, was directed by Jodie Foster.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Wow, my voice went really high there.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Awesome. What else has she directed again?
Jodie Foster was she's best known for Clarice in Silence of the Lambs.
Of course, that's why
and she was in the X-Files as well, I think.
Yeah, she was.
Yeah. She was.
Yeah,
in X-Files.
She was. It was the same woman. I can't remember. Yeah. It's bad. I'm a TV and film student. I can't remember half of
you
these.
You were
people.
A TV and film student. You can't say that.
Don't
anymore.
Do
You've
that
left.
To me, all right?
You've
I can feel
left.
The void. I can feel the void coming in on me, and it's not fun. Surely,
Surely.
Surely.
Shirley. I'm serious. Shirley. I'm serious. And don't call me Shirley. What a great...
I'm serious. Movie. Don't call me Shirley. Did you just say that's a great movie?
Yeah. Airplane.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay. No, don't worry. Don't worry. My head... Oh, my God. I'm so... My head went to Call of Duty Modern Warfare where they have Mile High...
I would like to note my look of displeasure on my face right now.
Oh, I can just hear Captain Price.
It's okay. I speak street.
Yeah, I speak street.
Oh, my God. Got to get the autopilot in. Oh, God. It's such a... Have you ever seen Blazing Saddles?
No.
Oh, it's brilliant. You need to watch Blazing Saddles.
Stop making me look so bad.
I am going to make you look bad.
Have you seen Incredibles? No.
You've seen The Incredibles?
Of course I've seen The Incredibles. Good, otherwise
we're going to have a massive problem. You haven't seen the second one yet, have you?
No, have you?
No, I was supposed to see it yesterday, and then I didn't end up going.
What's wrong with you, man?
No. We didn't end up going. It was just kind of didn't happen, unfortunately. But I really, really want to see it. Although, there are people have been saying there's like, I think it was the director, people were tweeting the director, who wrote it as well, and he was saying that he's acknowledged that the people that watched it when they were
young, so around my age, so about 4 or 5.
Yeah, 4 or 5, and then people from the 90s that will go, we were 10.
Yeah, exactly.
That's great. Great for you.
Yeah.
but yeah, younger people, and now that, of course, they are so much older.
Understand the jokes that are in it now.
Yeah, so it's, and they've written it, and apparently there's a couple of expletives in there. Lots of people were tweeting the director going, I've taken my young kids to see this.
Yeah.
Why have you got expletives in there? And it's like, animation doesn't... And his argument was, animation doesn't have to just be for kids.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is also proven through Family Guy, Sausage Party, which is...
Don't bring Sausage Party up. We don't need to think about the ending.
American Dad. American Dad as well. Anything
South Park.
South Park as
South
well.
South Park's the big one.
But I think in terms of in cinema animation, it's still very much, it's an animation.
Yeah.
We go to see the cinema. We take the kids on a Saturday morning. We go watch a film. The parents fall asleep
but
in the back.
At the same time, though, they say how... animated films shouldn't be full of explicitives. The one example that I've always remembered, Madagascar. You don't know... Oh, you don't know.
Oh, the sugar honey iced tea bit. Yes.
And everyone put past it.
Oh, sugar honey iced tea.
I told my parents about it and they only realised it a couple of months ago. Because I found it out about a year ago.
No, I remember seeing it on the internet or something.
I found it out about a year ago because I never really... I haven't watched Madagascar for years. I used to love that film.
That's King Julian.
My name is King Julian!
Such a good movie. Such a good movie.
The other two,
yeah, you had
not
to ruin
so
it with the sequels. I think that's the only similarity between Madagascar and The Matrix is they were ruined by their sequels.
Yeah.
Can you imagine, Marty? You can take the blue pill or the red pill.
But yeah, they always say, we didn't expect to see like alcoholism in the film. Obviously, from what I've seen in the trailers, obviously Bob Parr, who's the dad, if you don't know, finds it very struggling to be with the three kids. That's the whole point of the film, from what I can see.
Well, it seems to be from, because of course, as we've said, neither of us have seen it.
Yeah.
But it seems to be the plot of the first movie in reverse.
Reverse. That's exactly what I said to you last week, wasn't it?
Yeah, this is what we said last time.
Yeah.
But because of course she's...
She's gone off rather than
she's
gone
off than he's by a megalomaniac who probably owns an island. and she does get a new suit as well.
She gets a new suit.
Or is it a new building?
I can't tell if it's an old suit or not.
No, because her old one was white, wasn't it? And the new one's silver, so it must be a new sort of design suit. But
Edna is back.
Sorry, your ears. Definitely, Edna is
the
best movie. She is played by the director.
I know. It's a man.
And do you know what else is really...
And that screws my head heavily.
Going deeper into Pixar,
you
know that you haven't handed your paperwork in from Monsters, Inc.
Yeah.
He's played by the same guy, I think. I've now got doubts about this now that it's going on record.
That you're saying,
but I'm pretty sure that that is the same guy who plays Mater in Cars.
No.
Yeah. Oh my God, I had no idea of that.
What?
So I've just been looking to see if I am right. I'm wrong. It's not that. But what I didn't know is Chick Hicks from Cars, the green car.
Oh, yeah.
Do you know he's played by Michael Keaton?
He's not.
He's played by Michael Keaton. That's amazing.
And I bounce. Goodbye, everybody.
I love that. Oh, my God. I've always had... Yeah, I knew that Fillmore was George Carlin.
Yes.
The
amount of memes that are about Cars at the moment is bad.
That's really shook me up. Because now that I'm going back and thinking about it, I'm like, kajigga, 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 I can hear it.
What's funny is, you're going to look back on his career, it's like, oh, Michael Keaton, what did he do?
Cars.
Like, Batman. No, kajigga.
So Michael Keaton was in Cars.
Michael Keaton was.
Which is shocking to me. But because I can really hear it in the bit when he goes, you know, the twins that Michael, that Lightning McQueen has.
That's all you're going to hear from now on, isn't it? Just Michael Keaton as twins.
You know what I mean? The twins.
We love you, Lightning. Ciao, those guys.
Ka-chigga.
This has gone so far from what we've written down.
I like rabbit holes. I really like rabbit holes.
Okay. Alright, anyway. Now that I've stopped crying. Yeah. Right. Back on track.
Yeah. So Michael Keaton was in Cars, which I didn't know. We're now going to gloss over that quickly. Run over really
before
quickly.
We lose control.
But yeah, no, it's. There's like. Do you know the Pixar thing about. Is it A111?
A113, which is the room number.
The classroom. I've always liked that. And then I've seen so many videos.
Did you know Michael Keaton made that room? With twins.
Yeah, that's...
Glossing. Quickly move on.
Glossing.
Quickly move on.
Glossing. No, I... Yeah. And the Pixar theory, I've never quite understood.
What, where they're all interconnected
I think it was
different
timelines. The most random one I ever saw was that Bug's Life was something to do with after the end of Bug's Life, there is a nuclear explosion that wipes out all the humans, and the bugs evolve to become looking like cars.
Which is cars, right?
Yeah, so they're cars. So the cars are from Bug's Life, which is why in the post-credits scene as well, you have that section where these are the most amazing clown cars, that section. In the post-credit scene, when they reference all the other movies.
Oh my god.
The Pixar theory is so plausible.
Well, it's like Brave, isn't it? How Brave is... They're saying that the magic, the grandmother, who's one that created the lively animals and all that, and the toys. That scares me, because they've put...
It's
way
like,
too many decades worth
but
of
there
thought
is,
into
there
this.
But there is a very... Did you know... I was discussing this a couple of weeks ago with someone because they brought it up, and the when you realise what the Pixar theory is, it's so obvious.
Oh yeah, you can see the links quite easily.
No, not the links of like, how do Pixar think about how we're going to make a film? What we're going to make a film about? We give an inanimate object a personality, we give it something to deal with, and then that's it.
Holy.
We give bugs a personality, Bug's Life. We give cars a personality.
I mean, it'd
Bug's
be quite
life.
Boring.
We give
wouldn't
feelings,
it?
Feelings, inside out. I've just smashed Craig's childhood to bits.
See, the thing is, though, when you said we give inanimate objects life, all I can see is like Bug's Life just have David Attenborough hovering over the main character of Bugs, just
and
no
here,
speaking. Was it?
And here we see the bug. We should probably stop that before we get copyrighted.
What, doing a David Attenborough
voice? Can you copyright
a
voice?
No.
Because I know you can't copyright... No, you can copyright music.
Yeah, easily. But you can't really...
Because
if you're an impersonator...
No, but if you're... Yeah, that's a really good
point. I don't know. I mean, you might be able to copyright the phrases they say.
Yeah. Like catchphrases and stuff.
Yeah, I don't think you'd be able to copyright the voice.
Oh, yeah. Do you know the... I'm going to completely change tact again. You know at the beginning of Reservoir Dogs when they're all having that conversation about Like a Virgin by Madonna?
Yeah.
Did you know that... Because they all the characters in that film think that that song... This is where we become PG. Or they all think that that song is about Dick.
I thought you said no swearing.
No, they all think... No, they all think it's about...
Pedo.
Yeah, penises and stuff. And Madonna tweeted Quentin Tarantino and just went, "No, Quentin, it's not about Dick." It's just like...
It would have been so much better if she went, "Quentin, you caught me. I just can't help it."
Snap. yeah. No. Well, no, do you hear about the thing that happened the other week? I think
there's
it's probably about 3 weeks ago now with Johnny Depp.
There's a lot of bad things that happen with Johnny Depp at this point.
This one, right. So for anybody who doesn't know, Johnny Depp is currently shooting a movie in America. I think it might be LA.
It's not Fantastic Beasts 2, is it?
No, it's not. No. Basically, he was pretty drunk on set.
As per usual.
Was directing himself. The director had just gone, I can't control him. So the director had kind of just taken a back seat and was just waiting for him to calm down.
Yeah.
The producer was just like, we can't tell him what to do.
Yeah, we can't work.
And they were shooting on location. So production had closed off a whole street.
Oh, God.
And they'd run over by 2 hours. And the location manager ends up going to the producers, like,
what are you doing?
We need to open this street back up, otherwise we're going to get massively fined or something like that.
Yeah.
And the producers literally went, right, you tell Johnny that then. So the location manager walks over to Johnny Depp, tells Johnny Depp that he can't keep going. Johnny Depp wallops him in the face. Completely.
See, this is why bang. I don't like... I'll say this now, and I'll probably get punched by about 16,000 people if anybody listens to this.
So optimistic.
Yeah. I'm pessimistic, as you know. I've never liked Johnny Depp, ever. I've always seen him as an arrogant, stuck-up sort of guy. I don't know.
I have a very definite thing of... Just because I don't like someone's personality doesn't mean I can't like their work.
Oh, no, not at all. I love some of his work.
Pirates of the Caribbean, the first one, is amazing.
Yeah.
He's brilliant in it. If you've ever seen Public Enemies number one, Public Enemies, which is about John Dillinger, really good in that. Do I...
Sweeney Todd. What do you think of that?
I haven't seen that. Sweeney Todd.
That's actually half decent. You'd like it, I think.
I would. It's been one of those things that I've been meaning to watch for forever.
It's dark. It's dark. It's not very PG. It's a bit 18.
It's a bit 18, isn't it?
Yeah, it's
a bit. Is it the musical version?
Yes.
So they do...
he sings.
Pretty Women. That section.
Walking down the street. Sorry.
I don't even know what you were going for then.
You know, Pretty Woman. Walking down the street. Pretty Woman.
Yeah. That was so flat.
Don't care what you mean. Pretty Woman. I just would like to say
that we are actually this crazy. There is no.
Yeah, this is. Well, there is minimal alcohol, as well.
But this is a single beer.
This is a single beer, but I haven't had anything to eat, so.
Yeah, same.
Welcome to Drunk Podcasting. We should have
thought this through.
At least it was only the one. There's no more left, so.
Yeah.
We're good. We're safe.
Yeah. But I think I know that some this summer we've really kind of the production has amped up for movies. There are a lot of movies being made.
It's ridiculous. My name is Montoya Manto. You killed my father. Sorry.
Did you just say my name is Fiat Panta?
How did you know?
Transformers, roll out. My name is Inigo Montoya.
There we go.
You killed Inigo my father.
I've only seen it once. Yes, I've only seen The Princess Bride once.
The Princess Bride is one of the greatest movies ever made. To think that it's not is inconceivable.
Goodbye, everybody.
Yep. Drops mic. No, it's so good. You've got to love it. You can't not love it.
Well, you can.
Well.
Because I don't.
It's not the worst movie ever made.
Guys, if you just listen really carefully, you can probably hear my bones break as Tim punches me in the face.
Yeah, I'm thinking about it.
You've been thinking about it for years.
This is probably the point where we should say that this is informal, this podcast. This is... Yeah.
No!
If you hadn't already guessed, this is a nice informal chat and it's something that we'd like to do more of. Just have a chat, because otherwise it's all like, damn it, we're behind on production, as every filmmaker knows. You're always behind. You always don't have enough money.
I wondered why I was going bald. I found out why recently. It's because of you. What was that?
It's just so true. Me sending emails at 2 o'clock in the morning going, can I have the most recent script?
Sorry. I have to say something really quickly.
What?
Really quickly.
What?
Review on Mamma Mia. Here we go again. 3 stars.
3 stars out of 5?
Yes. It's bad as it should be.
I have to watch my tread here because I... That's
it's got a 5-star.
This is Mission Impossible.
Do you know what's funny? Skyscraper got worse than Mamma Mia 2.
Yeah. Yeah, that was...
Anyway, Moving on from Moving a on. Different type of...
Mission Impossible Fallout is apparently the best Mission Impossible ever made and one of the greatest action films of this decade.
I can see that being the case because from the trailers that I've seen, it looks like they're going back to like... Not going back to the... Obviously, the main antagonist from the first one's in this one.
Ooh.
You know the bit where in the trailer where you have the old guy saying all your loved ones will die and it'll be because of you and you can't stop it. That's the main bad guy from the first one.
Oh. So the next movie we should probably talk about, our penultimate movie, is the Downton Abbey movie. Yeah, so that's happening.
Why?
I don't think there is. It's only just been announced, and there's not really that much to say. But I haven't seen the series, so I don't know how much they've changed the cast. So it would depend if they're doing everybody from every episode ever into
probably
one movie.
Not considering a lot of deaths. But
okay.
Oh yeah, that whole Spoilers. Show is no, not at all. Not really, is it?
That whole, well, people die. Yeah.
Yeah. Welcome to life.
Welcome to life. Please get off at 74.
Whoa.
Yeah.
But. I just don't see the point of it. I mean, I was pouring champagne out when the final series was announced. Honest money.
There's a fan base for it. And I think it's something that people have been asking for a long time.
Yeah, it's true.
And when people are asking so much like that and you people are willing to watch it, studios go, right, we can finance this. It's a safe bet. It's got a large enough fan base for people to watch it.
It's true.
It comes back to the money thing. But then again, it all depends on who's making it, because if it turns out that Quentin Tarantino is directing that movie, I will be the happiest man alive.
Although, I don't think you would.
Although, because he's currently working on the Once Upon a Time in Hollywood movie with Leonardo DiCaprio and Brad Pitt.
Yep.
He's got the picture that came out of them the other day.
Yep.
That looks really cool. And then the other one that's been greenlit for him is he's doing an R-rated Star Trek movie.
He's not.
He is. I am in the same universe as J.J. Abrams lot.
Oh, yes. Oh,
because
sweet.
Because Tarantino has famously said that he only wants to make 10 films overall.
All right. Yeah. What, only 10 Star Trek films or 10
No,
10 films?
10 films. So, and he's currently made 9, but he does regard the Kill Bill as right. one movie.
Well, yeah.
Which is why you can buy Kill Bill as Kill Bill, one, The Whole Bloody Affair, which is one movie instead of Volume 1 or Volume 2. So he's only got 2 movies left.
Yeah.
So if the Once Upon a Time in Hollywood comes out, but the other thing that he has been on record saying that he really wants to direct before he finishes making his own films and then selling screenplays and stuff like that.
That's depressing, which is what he's going to do.
He really wants to do an absolutely terrifying horror movie. So,
that has a lot of potential.
What if you did like Alien, but even more scary?
What if you did that
in
the Star Trek universe?
With the Tarantino spin?
Oh my god, that would be.
I would like.
Quentin, if you ever listen to this.
Yeah, Quentin,
please.
If you somehow, please, just make it terrifying.
If anybody knows Quentin, if you're a family friend or a family member, whatever, please get him in contact.
Please, Quentin, we're begging you, please.
We live in England.
But if you couldn't tell by our voices.
You never know.
Oh my god.
So yeah, he wants to make 10 films, he's got 2 left.
Yeah, but he's gonna keep
making them, just not.
He's gonna keep writing screenplays and selling them. He's gonna write more plays and more books and stuff, and he'll probably direct some stuff on stage because he said he wanted to do that.
Yeah, that makes sense.
But in terms of films that he's done, but I don't know whether he's going to stick to it.
Part of me really doesn't want him to.
I know that there are people out there who really don't like Tarantino as a person.
Well, that's just...
There's stuff.
No matter what you do, no one's going to... Not everyone's going
to
like
But some stuff has come out about him, apparently, which I haven't had a chance to dig into very much, and Craig is looking at me quizzically, like, what
really
are you
confused.
On about? Yeah.
Might have to look after this there's
been some stuff, but as I said earlier, I always separate a person from their art.
Yeah.
You can always appreciate that somebody is very, very good at making something while they might be a complete idiot, regardless of what he did. And I don't like him at all. I've never liked him as a person. He's always creeped me the hell out. But Kevin Spacey is a good actor.
Oh, yeah, without a doubt.
Like House of Cards, brilliant. Usual Suspects, amazing. He's just a colossal bellend, to be honest. Just
I'll beep that out.
Words do not describe. The other big thing in film news that I found this morning, you can keep this section in.
Right.
The other big thing in film news is that Harvey Weinstein is apparently planning to plead not guilty to all charges.
Well, that's going to go well.
Yeah, but and the thing is, because there's been a fair few people that have tried to remain anonymous,
or that which have, means that have unless they come out, there's not going
to be. He can. Yeah. So if they don't come out, he can get away with it, or he can call them to the stand.
And that will screw
and
with them.
And they've gone, I believe, I don't know where the court is taking place. I don't know whether they're doing it in LA, because I know he has charges in LA, in New York, in London, in various places.
Yeah.
But I think there are some places where court records are public. Oh, yeah. Well, I think last thing we've really, really got to talk about, to be honest.
Yeah.
Is the RoboCop sequel, which I don't know when RoboCop came out. I'm guessing 2012, 2011, around that.
I think it was 2012.
Area.
It's around there.
So is that a little bit late?
I think the problem is that they've been expecting to do the sequel for ages. They want to do the same as what they did
they've
in the 80s.
They've probably had production struggle and stuff.
I have a feeling they've been in production limbo for a while. The only thing with that I can say is the first one was just a bit rushed. It felt the CGI.
I've only seen it once.
The CGI was poor.
Mm-hmm.
The screenwriting. It almost felt like a Force Awakens, but if the Force Awakens was done really poorly, it feels like that, as in the sense that they've
Last Jedi.
They've taken like the original idea and concept. I mean, I know it's a reboot, so I know you're supposed to do it, but usually in a reboot, you have different scripts. Spider-Man and Amazing Spider-Man.
My favourite fan theory about RoboCop, which has been confirmed, is that RoboCop is Jesus, because in the original movie he walks on water. Everyone was like, oh, he's Jesus, and then the director was like, do you know what, screw it, he's Jesus.
Yeah, he's Jesus.
Yeah, so on the note of RoboCop being Jesus, we'd like, if provided you made it to the end, I can imagine many people heard the first 5 minutes of this and were like,
bye.
I can't deal with Tim talking for however Tim and Craig talking for however long.
Pessimistic.
Oh yeah, I know, but I think hopefully we've hit on some interesting points.
Yeah,
and I'd say we've probably made you think that we're complete colossal idiots.
We don't need
to some
do
extent.
That.
We don't need anyone to know, because we know we are.
But
otherwise. So that's where we're gonna end today's podcast. I've been Timothy Lockwood, CEO.
I've been Craig Topping, Chief Creative Director.
And we'd like to thank you very much for listening. Thank you very much. Goodbye.
And goodbye.